Hi, I'm Ivana Hughes. I am a senior lecturer in the chemistry department. I teach and direct Frontiers of Science, which is our science core course. We have about 550 students taking the class each semester. And there's about 15 of us teaching seminars in the course. One of the things we discovered, especially with the move to remote teaching, was a platform named Gradescope, which allows instructor to provide students with individualized feedback, but to do that in a way that's a little more automated than sort of going through assignments one by one. So I have my Gradescope here. Currently, I have a couple of different things. I have a couple of trial courses. This is where we in Frontiers of Science set it up. And I even set myself up with like multiple email addresses as a student so I could really see what a student sees. So this is my section course. And if I go over here, there is a roster and I just entered all of my students into that roster. They then received an email and had to accept the course invitation. But at that point, all I needed to give them is just this link, the Gradescope link to my course, and they could find the assignments there and do everything there. So I'm gonna create a homework assignment. And what's happening now, so I'm gonna call this Molecules and Life Week 2 homework. And I'm going to select the PDF. So Molecules and Life Week 2 homework. This is the PDF I just uploaded. So what I have to do now is create an outline. I have to tell Gradescope where to look for answers to particular questions. And the way that works, so the first thing I create is a name region. This is where the platform is going to look for the student's name. I'm going to label the very first question. And in my case, the first question is gonna be this Q&A attendance. So we have a class session on Mondays that they're all supposed to attend and they just need to click on this. So basically this green region is where the platform's gonna look for an answer, and then on purpose making it big because some of my students write little notes here and don't just check this. So I'm gonna allow myself to see a kind of a bigger region of the bigger portion of their paper as an answer to that question. And now I'm gonna go to creating. So here's my very first question. And I'm just gonna make it a little big just in case anyone's writing in the margins. And that's gonna be my question 1AI. This outline is what the platform is going to use to search for their answers. I showed you how to set up an assignment, but I can also, there are things I can do to change it. One thing that Gradescope, when I was setting it up, it didn't give me all of these options. I didn't see everything. One thing that Gradescope seems to do by default is show all rubric items. I always, for all of my assignments, I always change so that a student is only seeing their own rubric items. Let me show you what the grading would look like when I go in to the Molecules in Life Week 1 homework. So this is the list of questions. This is sort of the outline that I had set up for this assignment. So if I click on this first question, I have the option to grade everything individually or the option to form answer groups first. I think that the forming of the groups is one place where an instructor can really spend save some time. You spend a little time to decide what those groups are going to be, but once you have them, then it really is just one click instead of, you know, and if you have a lot of questions, you know, 15 clicks times 12 questions obviously adds up. So in that sense, I really like reviewing the answer groups first. So it's telling me that some students had blank answers. That's entirely possible. And again, that's where where Gradescope is reviewing things on its own. I'm a little bit hesitant to just decide that Gradescope knows that there's no answer there. So I don't actually accept their group, and I just say delete and ungroup answers. So I'm now back in that mode where I'm just grouping myself. Okay. So I'm going to immediately create a group. Okay. So I'm always going to have some students who have an excellent answer. So I'm just going to already have a group great. And then as I begin to notice some difficulties that they're having, I'm going to create a new group. Okay, so this one is really great. So I'm going to add that here. By looking at their, yeah, so this is great. Okay, and now I'm gonna add, this one really is blank, no answer provided. So I'm gonna put that one in this group. Macromolecules, box angiotensin, small molecules. Yeah, this is fine, but it doesn't tell me. So create group, fine, but doesn't say how they know. Let me just, for the purposes of this demonstration, just add answers to one of the different groups here. So I'll say great answers. So this is my group great, right? So I'm going to add here instead of correct, great. Yes, we look in the PDB for all of the molecules. Okay, and I'm going to do that here. One of the things I can do is in addition to a rubric item, I can also write a specific comment that in this particular case, the whole group would see. But it, you know, sometimes I also have individual answers I leave without a group, and I can apply, let's say, a group rubric item to them, but then add a specific comment. If I add a comment for one student or one group, that comment will also show up here. And so I can apply it again in the future. Another thing that I can do is right here where the answer is, I have the option of adding additional text or crossing things out. So right where the student provided the answer. Let's say I really care about writing novel coronavirus. So I'm gonna, you know, add a word there. So I can, in addition to things being in a group, in addition to being able to provide comments, in addition to rubric items, I can also look at students' answers individually and correct them there. If you're doing this for more quantitative classes, I think this is really just super useful because you can, by visually inspecting them, you can very quickly group the answers and then apply the rubric items. They end up seeing that whole PDF, and then they see on the right hand side each of those questions that were listed for me as well. And then they click on it and they see a rubric item and they see any comments, and they can also see anything highlighted on the PDF itself, if I've done something there. This is pretty much what they see, to be honest. So I can see, it may not be exactly how they see it, but this is what they end up seeing. So they see where they got full credit. If they click on it, it will actually highlight that question where that question was. So that question was here, and they got full credit. When I go into assignments, and let's say I go into one that I have graded, so physics in reality, homework 3, well, there are lots of things I can see, right? I mean, I can see the minimum grade, I can see the median grade, the maximum was 14, the mean was 12, standard deviation 1.98. I can see the students who actually went back and viewed my feedback. And I can see that 3 of them did not. And then 1 student did not have a submission. I'm actually excited about grading my student work. That's the other thing. That has not happened in a long time. That I'm excited about, grading their homework. I love knowing that I'm giving them valuable feedback, but it just takes a long time. And when it feels tedious and it feels like I'm writing the same thing over and over again, this does give me a little more of a sense of like, oh, this is fun. I can do this.